So who betrayed Anne Frank? This has been a lingering question for decades, since the famous diarist and her family were outed to the Nazis in 1944. Now, a new cold case investigation using modern techniques has identified a surprise suspect, a Jewish notary named Arnold Vandenberg. The team investigators say he probably gave up the Franks to save his own family. The research is documented in a new book, The Betrayal of Anne Frank. It's by Rosemary Sullivan, and she joins us now. Rosemary, this is fascinating. Talk to us about the significance of this discovery. You don't say it was definitely Vandenberg, but you just talk about the evidence that points to it, the significance of that discovery.
Well, as you say, it's been 77 years since the arrest. And so to be absolutely definite is very difficult. We have circumstantial evidence, but it indicates that an anonymous note that was given to Otto Frank after he returned from the Auschwitz camp, having lost his entire family, the anonymous note identified Vandenberg as the person who had given over addresses of Jews in hiding. I think that's important. Vandenberg did not know who might be at those addresses. Indeed, even if people were still in hiding at those addresses, but he used that list, it would seem, to gain his freedom and the freedom of his family. And one of the significant points is that there was never any indication that Vandenberg was in a concentration camp.
So then is the sense is that essentially he decided to do this in order to avoid that fate? I mean, what more do we know about him as a person in the situation he was in?
Well, you know, he was a prominent Jewish notary. That's a very distinguished position. He was a collector of 17th and 18th century art, and as such had friends among naturalized Germans in Holland. He was working for the refugees who were fleeing Germany up to the war, and he used every means that was available to him from the Nazi hierarchy. They had special spears or stamps you could use to delay deportation. They had something called the Kalemeyer status, where you could prove that you weren't Jewish and get the J taken off of your passport. And in the end, when it finally came to being completely cornered, it would seem that addresses that he had obtained either from the Jewish Council, from the resistance, or perhaps he'd bought from one of the, as they call themselves, Jew hunters, he used those addresses to protect himself and his family.
Just historically, people should know he had been a member of a so-called Jewish Council, which were institutions that were used by the Nazis to oppress the Jews. They form these councils, exactly, right, of Jews and say, unless you help us govern the Jews in this city or country, we will kill you and your family. So it was a means of oppression, a diabolical means of oppression there. People just need to take that into consideration when they look at the totality of this. Rosemary, I am curious, why is it so important 77 years later to get these answers to what happened to Anne Frank?
You know, because it's in a much larger context. First of all, Anne Frank's story, while it is a universal story, it is also a Dutch story. And so the people who initiated this investigation, Thijs Beyens and Peter van Twisk, wanted the Dutch to face the complexity of the Second World War. But furthermore, I think it's a kind of warning. You watch Otto Frank, who's such a remarkable human being, in 1933, leaving Germany after a dinner party in which a friend says, hearing that Hitler has been elected chancellor, let's see what the man can do. Then you see the constant use of propaganda and lies and rhetoric and national violence building to war. So war is looked at in this context as what it really is, not heroic, good against bad or whatever, but in fact, the daily grind of fear and violence threatened at every pole.
And suffering. Rosemary Sullivan, it is fascinating. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.